You can see in that top panel that Infantino drew, he said the Flash is a runner. He's live. He's not muscle bound. If you've seen the movies and TV shows they made, they always make Flash muscle bound. But Infantino knew how to delineate him like a runner would be. And so the Flash was never muscle bound. But the Flash is all about, from Carmine Infantino's perspective, the two-dimensional delineation of speed like no one has ever done before. In fact, even when Infantino would draw a panel like the car, he said he was basing it on the fins and the cars from that era, like this image of a Chevrolet right here. So even the way he would draw a car moving was tilted and angled to get across on a two-dimensional plane the feeling of speed. Look at the bottom panel and how he draws that. Nobody to this day has ever delineated speed in a two-dimensional graphic way. The way we talk about Jack Kirby and power and Kirby Crackle, Infantino is all about the two-dimensional delineation of speed, whether it's usages like this or like this. I mentioned before about preparing an article comparing fine art to comic art. Now, Marcel Duchamp's New Descending a Staircase from 1926, I believe, is considered one of the greatest two-dimensional depictions of speed on a flat plane, but I would put up Infantino's version of the Flash with Duchamp's. In fact, when I see a beautifully rendered panel like this by Infantino's soulmate inker Murphy Anderson, I see the same beauty that we've seen for years in the famous Japanese waves. But I see the beauty of that in Infantino's speed. In fact, he's such the delineator of the Flash to this day that back in the day, he did one of these features about how to draw the Flash, and you could see how this would be so inspiring if you were a young comic artist or wannabe comic artist, and DC Comics would publish these things. And believe me, an entire generation of comic artists were out there in Artist Alley, learned from things like this, God bless DC Comics, would put into the annuals of their issues. Look how Infantino would rough out these strobe-like figures and then tighten them up before they would be inked. And it's the Flash amongst all the characters that Infantino drew in his practically 60-year career in comics that he's most known for. In fact, he didn't start out drawing the Flash originally. He came in a little later in the decade because he was also like Hubert, a teenager when he first broke in the early 40s. But by the end of the decade, he was one of their young sort of superstar artists. And he, I think, either created or co-created the character Black Canary. But as the superhero died in the 50s after World War II, he also drew other features about spies. Keep a mental note of this image because you're going to be seeing this image later on. Phantom Stranger was Infantino's assignments in the early 50s. And then, of course, Outer Space, and there he was also with the Damsel in Distress. But here we are by the mid-50s, and the decision is made up at DC. Nobody to this day knows exactly who decided to update the Flash of the 40s, and they gave it to Infantino, because he was the last artist to draw him, just like Hubert and Hawkman. And that's how you got the very first Flash, which kicked off the Silver Age for DC Comics and for the comic book world. Infantino himself says that he based the design of the Flash on the defunct character from the 40s who had been put out of business in 1953, Captain Marvel. If you look at the colors, the lightning bolt, you see where the Flash comes from. Also, because Barry Allen was hit by a lightning bolt, that's why Infantino said he used a lightning bolt motif. Of course, a year before The Flash comes out in 1955, when other publishers are trying out superheroes with failure, only DC with The Flash made it. There was actually a character like this. It had nothing to do with super speed, but he was called Captain Flash, drawn by future DC Justice League of America artist Mike Sikowski. You go back to Flash Gordon, again, no connection between the name Flash and Flash Gordon, although maybe there was. But the point is if you look at a sequence from 1940, Flash dresses up as a character, and you look at that costume, that's pretty much possibly influenced Infantino subconsciously to create his Flash. That Alex Raymond Flash came out, I think, a month later than the very first Flash in 1940. So again, who was copying or influenced by whom, no one knows for sure. But we do know that it was the Infantino design that, just like Ditko's design for Spider-Man, that's what made the Flash succeed. The next most famous cover that he did in 1961 for the Flash, 5 years later, was the very first Earth 2, where they would go back to the 1940s mothballed characters and bring them in to the modern age by coming up with this parallel universe thing. And it's one of the most famous issues from the Silver Age, because out of this one issue began the entire multiple universe worlds that both DC and Marvel traffic in. Now, the split cover, the symmetrical cover, is one of Infantino's most classic design motifs that you're going to see repeated over and over again, everything beautifully symmetrical. If you look down at the bottom of this 80-page annual, I think from 1964, you can see the Flash's Rogue Gallery, and that's also something that Infantino had a direct hand in creating, because according to Infantino, he created the Flash's Rogue Gallery before he created the Flash. He had a bunch of villains called the Villains of the Rainbow or something, where each villain was represented by a different color of the rainbow, and he was leaving those in his files, hoping to use them one day. So when the order came in 56 to start coming up with villains, he dipped into this rainbow villain bag of his and came up with villains like the Pied Piper. You can see in this cover another classic Infantino design motif with the flat perspective on the bottom, with everything receding to a vanishing point, but you don't see it. Everything's on that same perspective with the generic city skyscrapers in the background. Then you have Captain Boomerang. You can also start to see the angular motifs of Infantino's design concepts. The reason why he ended up becoming the art director and eventually publisher of DC in the late 60s was because his covers sold because they were so beautifully designed. I mean, look at this cover for the Weather Wizard, another one of Infantino's rainbow villains, and that sheet of water and how it works with the design motifs of the background. You have Captain Cold, who must have represented the color blue. Here's a way of showing Infantino's design motifs in that Captain Cold story, the way Infantino would design panels. Here's the Flash burrowing out of one of Captain Cold's ice caves, and as the panels go down, you can see this was a classic Infantino way of designing panels and action. He would throw in that little city in the background, which was practically generic at this point, to give a feeling of depth and space, but again, very simple. The backgrounds aren't busy. He focuses on the action and what's happening in the foreground of the panel. With Captain Cold, of course, you had to have Heat Wave, the exact opposite. And then in 1964, they all came together in one of the classic villains team-up issue of Flash running the gauntlet of supervillains. One of the most intriguing villains that wasn't pictured there is the Reverse Flash. And it gives Infantino a chance to show off his futuristic design motifs of the cities. Look at the bottom, how he goes from Central City in the silhouette on the left. Similar to this symmetrical panel that I used in the beginning of the presentation. And then later on, I think in 1965, you get this cover, another one of Infantino's symmetrical split panel designs. Here's the team-ups with the Golden Age Flash happen yearly, and then semi-annually and more often. If we look at this 1964 team-up, and we come in close on the Infantino villain, the Trickster, what do we have here but an actual fine art painting of the Trickster by the artist Mel Ramos, who's pretty famous from the pop art era, and it recently went on auction for hundreds of thousands of dollars. Of course, Infantino gets not a cut of that. It's the typical fine art Roy Lichtenstein type thing. Here's an image from the gallery. You can see, unlike Lichtenstein, who painted perfectly flat surfaces, Mel Ramos builds up his paint. This is from an exhibition recently of his pop art work. So you can see the type of work Mel Ramos did, and he actually was one of the first in the early 60s to make paintings, again, different from Lichtenstein's with the dots. Ramos was all about making the painting surface, but pretty much they're straight taken from the comics, similar to what he does with the trickster here, and is yet another example of the success, in a way, of comic art to penetrate the fine art world in ways you wouldn't normally expect them. But the covers Infantino did, and the villains, Abracadabra, here's another of his rainbow villains representing pure black and white, because light is devoid of color, or whatever, the ultraviolet is all the colors put together. The surrealness of images like this is what I call DC's dime store psychedelia of the 60s. And it was evidenced in covers like this that only an artist like Infantino could really pull off. I mean, you've got to really know how to draw to make an empty suit look convincing and even look a little menacing. In this 1966 story, one of the most surreal or indirectly surreal stories ever, Bob Kaniger, who wasn't the normal Flash scripter, but always did visceral, emotional stories, they do the story together about Barry Allen imagining his disembodied costume talking to him. And because of events in the story, the cover image, halfway through the story, he decides to give up his identity. And that's the cover. But in the story, as he leaves the costume, it's like he's left a friend behind or a fellow soldier. And if you were a kid reading the story, man, this freaked you the F out. Look at that image. That'll give you nightmares. Look at this image. The skeletal empty hand that Infantino drew, telling Barry Allen to come back. And of course, like Twilight Zone mode, Barry Allen saying, I must be imagining this. And there it is. The suit crying, pleading with him to put him on. And that's why that story ranks as one of the greatest superhero stories of the 60s. It's like a Twilight Zone episode. Infantino took this same surreal dime store psychedelia bent in 1963, when he and editor Julie Schwartz came up with Strange Sports Stories. Here's one of the beautiful house ads lettered by the great god of DC lettering, Ira Schnapp. That's all hand lettering, folks. They don't letter them like they used to anymore. The gimmick of Strange Sports Stories, if you want to call it a gimmick, here's a blank page that I've reconstructed, is that Infantino would use his mastery of captions and hands to enhance the storytelling of the story. So it was all about strange sports and science fiction being put together, but Infantino came up with this motif that they would use, so he would have the hands directly addressing the viewer as you read these thin, long, vertical panels across the page. The images have to do with a story that's virtual reality, you know, 30 years ahead of its time, being done in 1963, but it's about being hooked up to, in a sense, a computer and living and feeling those science fiction sports that you were playing along with. Sometimes he would use the panels like in an animated film to advance the action. So the silhouette begins the throw and then the illustration completes it. Or a spaceship, as only Infantino could design spaceships, silhouetted in the panel and then drawn. I put together a collection of his beautiful silhouettes for the end papers for a hardcover book on Infantino that came out in the early 2000s because they're so beautiful and they say so much with so little, which was one of the greatnesses of Infantino. He was a master of the silhouette and of changing line weights to indicate distance. So the city or the town in the background is rendered just in line with the bold silhouette. This bold silhouette was a feature of Infantino's mature style, which, like Joe Kubert, really begins in the late 50s, early 60s. And you can see whether it was Westerns or whether it was his science fiction stories, which Infantino was a master of, you can see again the flat perspective, everything on a single horizon line, and just changing the size of things as they go back in space. Infantino's trademark high-tech buildings and machinery. Here's an image from that's, I think, pretty emblematic of his design sense for buildings, which probably comes out of the 1930s, very Deco, very Alex Raymond. In contrast to the suburban motifs, the California modern that he would employ in the suburban settings of the Flash stories, there's an architectural rendering of that California modern architecture and what Infantino did. Here's an ad from an interior design magazine from the early 60s and how Infantino incorporated those motifs in his artwork. This was a panel for his other classic series, Adam Strange, which basically split time between Earth's first spaceman on Earth and his adopted planet, Ron, which he traveled to via being hit by a Zeta beam on Earth, and then, as you'll see in the sequence, lands on Ron. What I want you to start to notice here are these beautiful figures, the flying figures of Adam Strange. Notice the ones I'm going to show you. You never even see Adam Strange's face. Usually an artist would draw the character coming at you, or where we can see the face, not Infantino. He fell in love with drawing Adam Strange from behind and showing you these beautiful live figures that he himself says, they're not muscle bound. In fact, there's even a feminine quality to Infantino's figures because he was influenced by the very long, lanky, feminine figures of the painter Modigliani, which you can see in his Adam Strange work. Again, all these images that I fell in love with, inked by the great Murphy Anderson, a soulmate, you'd never see Adam Strange's face. You just see Infantino's facility with the human figure and the grace and the balance and the beauty. Again, these are newsprint Benday dot coloring. This is not computer coloring, but I will take this coloring over any modern computer coloring. Look at the beautiful silhouette. Look at these landscapes that Infantino and Anderson drew. Just gorgeous, where Adam Strange isn't doing anything but standing there. And again, that's a panel, maybe it's 3 inches wide. But when you blow it up like this, if I were having a museum exhibition, I would just take these images and blow them up this big. You don't need to be Roy Lichtenstein and repaint them. You just need to show them as beautiful pieces of artwork. Look at the fidelity with the reeds and the vegetation. Look at what Infantino did with color. He even said, my Batmans were darker, but my Flashes Adam Strange, I left open for color. Look at how he designs this panel after Adam Strange loses the woman that he loves. He's left all alone. You feel that solitude in the way Infantino places, once again, the figure from behind. He based that panel, he told me in an interview, on the paintings of a Chinese painter named Chen Qi, who he said would do these beautiful canvases with a single figure off to one side. The horizontal panels that he employed Adam Strange in, you can see the beauty here. You can feel the weight of that figure. Ooh, I'm sorry. You can feel the weight of that figure in the lower panel, leaning on that lever, the way Infantino slightly tilts the angle. And if you read the script, this is the job of the illustrator to take that script and bring it to life so that as you read the words, you feel through the master of illustration what that character is feeling. The vertical panels to show flight that Infantino did so masterly, he said he was influenced by the dancers that Degas painted. And you can see it in here, and in perhaps his greatest cover of all time, Mystery in Space number 90, 1964, which recently, the original art, went for over $100,000 at Sotheby's. At the time of this cover, science fiction was working for Adam Strange, but it wasn't working for Batman. Ever since the late 50s, Batman had lost his way. Stories like this, placing Batman and Robin in science fiction settings, did nothing for sales of the character. And by the end of 63, Erwin Donnefeld, the head of DC, said to Infantino and his editor, Julius Schwartz, if you don't rescue Batman from stories like this, we're going to have a problem. So, in 1964, late 63, Erwin Donnefeld and Carmen Infantino and Julius Schwartz got together and they did something pretty terrific. Oops, hold on. I thought I was linked. Give me 1 second, guys. No. If anybody experienced it, remembers it, went through it, you know what an insane asylum it was. It was like all three Star Wars films put together in 1 year, and Infantino was instrumental. Now, what happened with Infantino, the Batman TV show, is very interesting. These were the stories that he was told to bring more down to earth, get rid of the science fiction thing. So literally, in one issue, you went from this image to this image, much more realistic, much more down to earth. What was called the New Look in 1964 featured Infantino's art, and in fact, it's pretty amazing that in a medium directed to children, that a house ad would promote artwork as something to strive for, and therefore a whole generation of kids like me and adult artists that are out there in Artist Alley were influenced by attitudes like this that would make us appreciate the artwork that was in comics. So Batman, in one fell swoop, went from Bat Baby to more gothic stories like this that traded upon the mysteriousness of Batman's background, which in 1964, nobody was using the expression Dark Knight, believe me. But it was darker covers like this that ended up planting the seeds that later artists like Neil Adams and Frank Miller would capitalize on. And the very first New Look cover, where you can see Infantino's trademark design motifs, look at the bottom, and it featured a backup story of one of Infantino's favorite characters, the Elongated Man, who started out as a Plastic Man knockoff from the pages of Flash, but in 1964 was taken out of Flash and put into the backup Detective Comics. It's not, of course, coincidental that the long lankiness and the stretchability of Elongated Man fits in again with Modigliani's longer, stretched-out figures. What's amazing about these couple Elongated Man stories that Infantino does in 64 is one of the few times that Infantino inked himself. And if you're an aficionado of inking, I love Infantino inked by Anderson, but there's something about Infantino's inking of himself. It's a little scritchier. His use of blacks, if you look at this full page image, to delineate the water, purely with ink, and yet it gives it literally so much depth. The covers, one after another, these were the covers, again, that not only increased sales of Batman and saved him from cancellation, but also Infantino took the time to design a new logo for Batman, which is one of my favorite logos. He worked with the great god of DC lettering, Ira Schnapp, but that face and the bat shape is pure Infantino, inked by Anderson. It debuted on one of the greatest dime store psychedelic covers that Infantino and DC produced. You gotta love that pink color, the pink and the green. This cover, debuting that 1965 Batman logo, was the issue that was adapted for the very first Batman TV episode, that first two-parter. Now, what's interesting to know is that while he did the cover, Infantino didn't do the interiors. William Dozier, the producer, who didn't know anything about comics, had picked up this issue on the newsstand in 1965 on his way to ABC to have a meeting about this new Batman TV show. In it is a story that wasn't drawn by Infantino. It was drawn by Bob Kane's ghost, a knockoff artist named Shelley Moldoff. So you can see in the story, Batman and Robin are outside the window. In the TV show, when they crash through the window, this was taken right from that Shelley Moldoff story where they burst inside and capture the Riddler. And almost scene for scene, the images are the same from the TV show to the comic. But the artwork is stiffer, it's not Infantino. We knew something was wrong when the opening animation, that didn't look like Infantino. That looked more like the earlier Batman of Shelley Moldoff from the 50s. That cardboard cutout Batman and Boy Wonder. It didn't look like the cool, sleek Infantino Anderson Batman. This wasn't the Batman we got on the TV show. We got basically a knockoff of Dick Sprang. It didn't look like the Infantino Batman. Do these guys look like these two idiots? Okay, Burton Ward, I'll give you, looked a little like the Infantino Robin. But even to my 8-year-old eyes, they didn't look like Infantino Batman. They looked just like the old Batman that Infantino supposedly did away with. Why? Because on that same newsstand that Dozier bought that Batman comic, there was a Batman annual, reprinting stories by Moldoff and Dick Sprang from the 50s. So Dozier read these stories, didn't know anything about comics, and the stories that were reprinted were some of the very first Batman TV show episode adaptations. So the Joker's utility belt was used for one of the first Joker two-parters. The Catwoman story in that annual was used. There was a Penguin story. This is why you got those villains in the beginning. Even Mr. Freeze was in that 1965 Batman annual, god damn it. And that's why even the costumes, this is what Batman and Robin looked like in live action, but that's the costume designs of the costume designer. I don't think she was looking at this art when she did those costumes. But Infantino was a good soldier and did some great promotional art to help promote the series. And of course, the comic books had to follow suit in 1966 and start reflecting the art. Here's another piece of Don Stewart psychedelia with the go-go checks and the Irish Snap lettering. When Irish Snap lettered letters that were going, they were moving like they were going. He did the first Batman Aurora figure model that actually predates the Batman TV series, but ended up being right on time. And I must have had like 50 of these, because back then, like lather, rinse, repeat, you would build a model, screw it up, blow it up, buy it again, build it, screw it up, blow it up, buy it again. But Infantino literally was the model for Batman, all the advertising and promotion. He basically did Ink by Murphy Anderson. Also, he was the go-to guy when you need a model sheets. Just like he did for The Flash, there was a how to draw Batman like Carmen Infantino. When the TV series asked DC Comics, we need more women on the show, it was Infantino that came up with Batgirl. Here's how she looked in her original 1967 appearance. But, of course, when it got to television, Yvonne DiCarlo made out of it. Here's how she ended up looking like on television as Batgirl. You tell me, what does that design on the right really have to do with Infantino's design for the comics? He also designed Poison Ivy on a request from Hollywood for more female characters. But for some reason, I think they wanted to get Ann Margaret for the TV show. It didn't come through. These two images that Infantino and Anderson created in the wake of the Batman TV show became icons from that era that have been used in so much merchandising. They were double page spread pinups. And in those days, there were no posters, there were no t-shirts. This is all the companies gave us. We had to take out the staples or buy a second issue and hang those up. You can hear the frustration still in my voice. There's a poster that was made with, again, the iconic classic Infantino Batman. That's not Adam West's physique. That image on the right, you've seen a million places. Infantino the designer, look at the round moon behind. That became a motif he would return to time and time again in these great covers that he created. Here in 1966 or 67 is one of his most psychedelic characters, the Spellbinder. Look at that costume. His covers were very diagrammatic. There's those pointing hands from Strange Sports Stories. If you love typography, look at the prominence of the type here, again, by the god of DC lettering, Ira Schnapp, who designed the Superman telescopic logo and every DC logo you could think of. But again, it's more diagrammatic. It's more single icon images. Look at, tells you all you need to know for the bat signal and the silhouette of the city. It was Infantino's art that was all over licensing that you may know more from licensing than from the actual comics during the TV show. In fact, the licensors took this one small panel from a 1965 Batman story with DC's knockoff of the Hulk. And it was all over merchandising, everywhere you went. Here's the cans that I showed in the beginning. They used that duo over and over again in merchandising everywhere. Infantino did posters to promote the show. Here's the house ad. Look at that Batmobile down below. Here's the poster from it. Infantino's art shot off the page. Look at the height and look at the feeling that he was able to get in an inanimate object like the Batmobile to have it actually leap. Infantino played around on his covers with trying to get the feeling in almost like a trompe l'oeil, a three-dimensional space of characters literally leaping off the covers. In the wake of the TV show, they reprinted this 3D comic from the 1950s. Of course, Infantino was brought in to draw it. Speaking of three dimensions, here's the box cover of a color form set. That the interior art, that's your Sheldon Moldoff head, versus the more realistic, the more modern Carmen Infantino head. One of his most famous covers, and one of my favorites, speaking of color forms, is where he would design it like a jigsaw puzzle, so God bless Photoshop, we're able to actually see if this design by Infantino actually works when we take the actual jigsaw pieces and stick them back in the illustration as Infantino designed it and intended it. And there we have it, the complete cover. This appeared in 1967, Infantino's last full-time year as an artist, before it was covers like this that got him promoted to the art direction spot because they sold well, and DC head at the time, Irwin Donenfeld, recognized Infantino's skill in making some pretty outlandish ideas come alive, like again, this sort of dime store psychedelic thing of Batman seeing himself on the newsstand, or Batman larger than life looming over Gotham City in symbolic covers. One of the greatest dime store psychedelic covers is the house the Joker built, appearing 2 months before perhaps Infantino's greatest, most famous Batman cover, in which he literally smashes the logo. This appeared at the same month in 1967 with perhaps his most famous Flash cover, uniting the Rogues Gallery's villains standing on top of the logo, probably his homage to the great Will Eisner and the Spear logos. But you gotta remember, back in 1967 when that cover appeared, nobody knew about Will Eisner. If you were young, the stuff wasn't reprinted. Eisner really didn't return until Steranko wrote about him in 1972. This cover has been lampooned so many times, I'm only showing one version of it. But it was the covers Infantino did in 67 that have become classics that are, whether it was conflict or working together, these covers in 67, Infantino was at the height of his powers. Look at this cover. Look at the strong diagonals. Look at how the type works with the image versus fighting it. Look at the sense of scale, of motion. Then again, look at the angles and look at Infantino is up to this all the time. This is from 1964. It's one of my most favorite covers because look at what a difference 10 years or so makes in the life of an artist, because that's the same character that Infantino drew in the early 50s. And look at how much he grew as an artist in about a dozen years, where this image is almost abstract. I love the house ads that DC did with Irish Snaps lettering, really making those comics come alive. One of Irish Snaps' greatest house ads was this house ad in late 1967. Just as Infantino was making the transition from being a full-time artist, he creates this character with the writer Arnold Drake called Deadman. There's the writer's sketch for Deadman that he gave to Infantino. It was probably unconsciously or subconsciously based on a Batman villain that had appeared a year before in 1966 called Deathman. But Infantino wisely changed it and created the Deadman character. The very first story written by Drake made Marvel's dialogue by Stan Lee seem almost like My Pet Goat. Nobody had ever seen such an anti-hero as Deadman spitting out this kind of dialogue, if you can read that. And the woman saying, "I can't stand it when you talk and look that way, that costume and makeup." She was echoing us, the readers. We had never seen a character look like that. And that's the genius of Infantino's design. Deadman is a character who performs an airless without a net. He falls to his death. By this time, Infantino was purely designing. Look at the tilt here as Deadman comes back to life. Look at the Benday newsprint coloring, very stylized, as Deadman makes his way outside of the circus tent towards the light. He starts communing with a tree that says it's the spirit, an old Indian spirit, India like India, India, Ramakrishna, that gives him the power to inhabit people's living form. So he goes into the circus strongman, and he busts up a drug ring. Now, in 1967, the Comics Code didn't allow anything about heroin or opium, but DC snuck it in. Arnold Drake, snow, poppy juice, opium, baby. I remember being 9 years old, reading those words, going, "What the hell is snow? What is opium?" I can barely pronounce the word. But that's how groundbreaking the single Deadman story was. Drake said he took the whole Ramakrishna thing from the zeitgeist. 1967 was the year the Beatles went to see the Maharishi in India. Even the villain, the Hook, he took from the recently ended series, The Fugitive, which at the time had the highest ratings of any show in the summer of 67, for the finale in which the Richard Kimball character catches up with the One-Armed Man. Of course, Drake changed that from the One-Armed Man to the Hook in Deadman. Then history was made when Infantino leaves Deadman after the first issue to assume being the art director and eventual head editor and publisher, leaving Deadman in the capable hands of newcomer Neil Adams, who goes on to change the very look of comic book art itself. But he couldn't have done that without Infantino beginning it with Deadman. As Infantino assumes that role in 68, they put out a DC special that's a retrospective of his work. And here's his own self-portrait, the black and white original art. And there's Infantino in 1968, planning things for DC, like these house ads, in which he was entrusted with changing up the stodgy company to compete with the Marvel juggernaut that by 1967-68 was overtaking DC. So, with newcomer Neil Adams as almost his protege, Infantino starts to let the art take over DC Comics. And Neil Adams begins to reinvent Superman, Batman, and all the DC heroes underneath Infantino's stewardship. Infantino takes genres that have been worn out, like the Western, and comes up with characters like Batlash, giving artists like Nick Carty their career-defining work. He lets editors like Joe Orlando become, he lets artists like Joe Orlando become editors. He starts up horror comics again in the late 60s with new blood like Bernie Wrightson, creating along with Len Wein this new character, Swamp Thing. So the fact that House ads like this were appearing for DC were startling if you were a DC reader. And that's why under Infantino's tutorship, we have Swamp Thing. He let Joe Kubert become the editor of Sergeant Rock, not just the writer. And that's why we got these veiled anti-war attempts, because Kubert, an artist, was in charge. And it was Infantino that engineered this publicity coup in 1971 of having the New York Times Sunday Magazine cover that Me Lie reference issue. Under Infantino's leadership, they got the rights to Tarzan to give to Kubert. They got the rights to Shadow so that young newcomer in Bernie Wrightson's wake, Mike Kaluta, would make a name for himself and is now considered the definitive shadow artist, or at least shadow comic artist, of all time. Under Infantino, they got the rights to Captain Marvel after 20 years. He instituted the famous first edition Treasury reprints, which turned on a whole generation like Alex Ross onto the history of DC's golden age, which in the early 70s, like I said before, was pretty non-existent in terms of quality reprint collections. It was Infantino's sketch and his leadership that created the first comic book crossover when they did Superman vs. Spider-Man, which was later finished by Ross Andrew and Dick Giordano. And it was under Infantino's leadership that the Superman Muhammad Ali project came to be. And Infantino designed and laid out the Treasury-sized reintroduction of Superman's origin in 1976, which helped pave the way for Infantino working on the script and the development of the Christopher Reeve Superman film. So Infantino's legacy is not just an artist, but as an editor and publisher and leader and bringer in of new talent and new blood. We can still see in movies Infantino's legacy as they go to make a Flash movie. And here's the costume that they've come up with. And it's your typical modern 21st century high-tech version, but the Infantino influence is still there and is still part of his legacy. And we see that in a recent book published by Paul Levitz, ex-DC president and publisher, when in the recent coffee table book, The Silver Age of DC Comics, they put that issue on the cover. So it's, again, the Flash is just one of a universe of characters that Infantino did and drew in these beautiful images that survive him. I found this one image in my research that I thought would be fitting to end on. When Infantino either drew himself as a child reading comics, or he drew the ideal child reading DC's wares. But I'd like to think that I was probably like many of them who actually lived this image in my own life. Thank you very much. Wow, on time again, I can't believe it. We actually have time for some Q&A or comments or questions. Anybody? Nice to see. I want to thank you all for being here and showing some love to Infantino. Anybody? Yes?
When you said Murphy Anderson was his soulmate, did you just mean artistically, or was that actually...
Were they lovers?
Yeah.
I don't think so.
Okay. I was just curious.
He was his soulmate anchor, I'd like to think, although he brings up Murphy Anderson. Now, fans like me think Infantino Anderson was one of the greatest penciling inking teams. Are you ready for this? Infantino didn't like Anderson's inking on his pencils because, according to Infantino, he was trying to leave out what he called a lot of the drawing and make it pure design. And he would complain to editor Julius Schwartz, Anderson is putting back in the drawing I'm trying to leave out. Meanwhile, Anderson, the inker, was complaining to Julius Schwartz, the editor, whenever he got an Infantino assignment, saying, you need to pay me more because I'm putting in all this drawing that Infantino's leaving out. Neither man liked the other's work, and yet, we considered their work, I would consider Gene Colan and Tom Palmer, who were also inking, penciling soulmates, they loved each other's work. I consider Jack Kirby and Joe Sinnott to be soulmates, although some Kirby fans would say it's Mike Royer. I'll take Sinnott. Then I would consider Kurt Swan and George Klein, his anchor during the 60s, who had a very thick, thin, Sinnott-like line. Those, to me, are the four greatest penciler anchor teams, I think, in comics, who literally were like a yin-yang and complemented each other so perfectly. Yes, all the way in the back there. And just speak loud, because I'm hard of hearing, and I'm fighting off sounds from both rooms.
One interesting thing, I don't know if I should mention this or not, just like the last, maybe what Wizard World show, Neil Adams was there, and he was basically giving a symposium on art, and he did a thing basically on, he mentioned what he thought good art and bad art, and someone brought in the Superman, Spider-Man cover, and he said, this is a bad cover. I love Adams, but I was thinking.
Okay, so is it a question or comment? Again, I only got some of that.
Comment?
Yep. That Adams criticized the cover that Infantino designed? You know, that Superman, Spider-Man thing is a mystery in terms of what Neil Adams actually did on that. There's a lot of places in the book where he fixed up a lot of Ross's pencils. I think Neil would rather have drawn that from scratch. But this is the first time I'm hearing that he would badmouth the cover. Was this done while Infantino was still alive?
No, it was done just like a few months back in June.
Right, so maybe he said that now that Infantino has passed on. I don't think Neil, it's been my experience, I worked for Neil Adams in the 80s, that he would never badmouth a living artist. He always had something nice to say about everything. Privately, he might have said how much he might not have liked something, but very rare for him to really criticize something. But again, maybe that's because with Infantino gone.
He didn't mention his name at all or anything. He just commented on the cover.
Right.
He mentioned several covers.
Any other comments or questions? Yes?
Much like you did with Joe Kubert and putting this sort of presentation into a publication, which I was able to get, Have you done the same with the Infantino presentation?
I didn't bring it with me, but, you know, in my book, you know, the Infantino chapter has a lot of the same images, obviously. This is like a live version. Vanguard came out with a book called The Amazing World of Carmen Infantino. It's a black and white book, but there's a 16-page colored section that I wrote and designed that, again, is similar to these layouts. Like, I've been working with these layouts and designs pretty much the past 15 years or so, depending on the venue that I have. There was a 75th issue of Comic Book Marketplace magazine from 1999 that is the first iteration of all these designs. So there was that, then Amazing World came out in 2000 or 2001, and then came my book in 2003. So those publications all have various iterations of the same basic design concepts. And pretty much they're all posted on my site. If you go to artandshooter.com or when I leave here, if you want to meet me outside, because I know they want to get the next person in here. But I'll give you my card, go to my site, pretty much everything's there. I'm hoping to get my Silver Age book back in print, and maybe even with electronic edition, if I can find an agent and a publisher. Other than that, I'm ready to go. Anybody else? Wow, the luxury of time. Such a beautiful thing. Yes?
Yeah, I've heard that near the end of his life, it was hard for him to get work. Did you make any comment on that?
It's hard for everybody to get work at the end of their life. I mean, we all can't be Neil Adams, so to speak, at 73 years old or 2 years old, doing the amount of work he's putting out right now. We all face that point in our lives where you get to a certain point in age where you don't get work. I mean, you know, comic art, the publishers, the editors, you know, you look at the roster of artists now, I don't recognize any of them, they're from all over the place. But yeah, I mean, it's ageism, it's the same thing where, but also depends on your skills. And Infantino considers his artwork an unfinished symphony, because when he stopped drawing full time in 67, he then returned when he was fired from DC in 77. His drawing was never the same. That 10-year gap kind of atrophied his skills. But Infantino was at the peak of his game in 67. We will never know, and that's why the metaphor of the unfinished symphony, we'll never know where Infantino might have gone. When you look at that Flash cover and that Batman cover with this broken logo, Who knows where Infantino would have gone as an artist had he stayed a full-time artist. So yeah, when he came back, he worked for another, 10 years or so. His work eventually went downhill. And then, he was a shadow of his former self. But I think that goes for society in general. We all have to figure out how to remain vital as we get older. Thanks for bumming me out, man. Jeez, I was feeling good until that.
Seriously.
Yes.
Even that later period, I mean, his art's still better than 99% of what's out there now. And I don't understand how come that stuff's so popular. You have people that make so much money for a book, and, I mean, I'm not going to drop any names, but, you see, okay, I won't drop any names. But you see that, and it's not nearly as good as even him on his downward slide. So
yeah, I mean, listen, again, with more time and all that, some of the work he did when he came back in the late 70s, he was inked by Terry Austin on some Star Wars stuff that was nice. Klaus Janson inked him on some Daredevils. For a couple of years there in the mid to late 80s, Infantino was still okay, but I would say by the mid 80s, his drawing had kind of fallen apart, similar to like a Jim Aparo. I loved Aparo in the early 70s, but by the late 70s, by the 80s, I felt his art decline, whereas kids who grew up with him in the early 80s think he's great. So it's what I call the gauze of childhood. Whatever affects you as a kid, you think is great. And when you become an adult, you really got to look back at some of that stuff and separate the wheat from the chaff and lift that gauze of childhood and go, holy shit, I can't believe I like this stuff. Some of it's like that.
With a part, when you look at the stuff like Green Arrow in the 90s, that's completely different from, say, his Batman.
Absolutely.
I know what you're talking about.
Absolutely.
But the 80s Batman still gold. I mean, come on.
But again, beauty's in the eye of the beholder. What is that, 5 minutes? Just tell me when you want me to go. I'll talk right up until that 5 minutes. Just tell me when you, where's the hook? Just pull it up. Yes?
Yeah, I'll give you a funny story to cheer you up again. I wasn't really familiar with Carmen Infantino. I probably as a child.
How did they let you in here? How did you pass this security?
Well, I mean, I know about it now because I've been collecting comics in later years, but I wasn't totally familiar with the old.
Right.
Chances are I probably was exposed to it when I was younger. I probably didn't know who he was.
Right.
But I had a late friend of mine who basically grew up on the scene, and he used to talk a lot about the comics and stuff. And he always kept always making a joke about the fact that Carmen Infantino always had this, he was just a very, it seemed like his line work basically, when people stood or anything like that, they were always like on a, they were always on this even line where it's just so perfect. So he used to say it was like, taken to it like a perfect ruler. But then he also used to talk about the fact of Carmen Infantino's obsession with apes.
Yes.
And
if you notice, I didn't talk about that at all because I could care less about apes. But yes, Infantino loved drawing Detective Chimp. And then by the way, he actually badmouthed his own Batman. He says, I never liked drawing Batman. Then, of course, in the last couple of years after Dark Knight became successful in the movies, all of a sudden I started reading interviews with Infantino. I love drawing Batman. No, you didn't. He didn't like drawing Batman, but he was saying that at the end of his life. He enjoyed Flash, didn't enjoy Batman, loved Detective Shim, loved Elongated Man, but of course, Julius Schwartz wouldn't let him ink it because he was too valuable as a penciler, just like Jack Kirby.
Oh, I never heard of Detective Shim. I mean, I know of Gorilla Grodd, and then there's that silly Superman family story with Lois Lane and the ape.
Irwin Donenfeld, the head of DC, sales of Gorilla-themed covers, for some reason, shot through the roof. So, listen, they're businessmen. They figured out a way to get Gorilla Grodd, and Batman had a giant gorilla. I mean, you look at DC, it's part of that dime store psychedelia, this obsession with gorillas and apes.
Can you ever explain why he had this thing?
Why did they sell? I don't know. But then, again, look what happens in 68 with Planet of the Apes.
Yeah.
So, Infantino and Donenfeld were, in a sense, vindicated. And look at the success of Planet of the Apes Redux. So, I mean, maybe they were onto something. We laugh at those comics, but obviously, once again, comics and all these great Silver Age comics, like I showed you that Strange Sports stories about virtual reality, that was 1963. We were reading about that as kids, before real virtual reality. So the great comics of the Silver Age were so far ahead of their time that they're really, like I said, some things are just sort of coming true now. I think, should that wrap it up? Unless, yeah, I mean, I think that's it. But anyway, everybody, I want to thank you. I'll be outside if you want to, like I said, get my car there. But thank you.